I was like, this has got to be some scam book. Like, I'm not doing this multi-level marketing something. But then my buddy was kept saying like, no, dude, you got to read it. And, you know, now I'm like so into this right now. I like to tell people I spent the first 25 years becoming the best engineer. I'm spending the next 5 getting the hell out of it.
Welcome to the Going Long Podcast. We're back once again to continue to help to educate you so that you feel much more comfortable as well as confident investing beyond your backyard. And yes, I'm your host, Billy Keels, and we're back once again for another fantastic conversation. I can't wait for you to listen to today's conversation. You're going to get a lot out of this, especially if you're someone who is in a high-paid professional job and you are looking to gain more control over your finances and your outcomes of your life. Before we do that, I just have a couple things that I want to say very, very quickly because I want to share that with you because I continue to be excited. We, as a Going Long family, continue to move up in the podcast ratings, and that is awesome. And it's really, really thanks to you continuing to be here, listening to the podcast, continuing to also let us know what you like. Let us know what you want to see different and all that kind of stuff. So basically, at the end of the day, it's about you leaving your honest written reviews as well as ratings. So many of you are doing that. And if you have not had a chance to do that yet, feel free to just very quickly go think about any of the episodes that you've listened to because you've been here for over like 160 some odd episodes, which is awesome. And so honest written review, rating, we'd really appreciate that because it will help to continue to also attract fantastic guests. And for those of you that are looking to understand more about how you can find any of the old episodes, maybe you can't find them on your favorite platform, all you have to do is go to billykeels.com. When you get to billykeels.com, just look for the podcast tab. Click the podcast tab and you can see every single podcast we've ever done, audio, visual, the video version, all of the guest responses. It's fantastic. So just go there, check it out, and it will be awesome. Go to billykeels.com. Check out the podcast tab and you will find every single episode. And lastly, for those of you who are interested in being a part of a group, a community of accredited investors, I would invite you to send an email to aiclub@billykeels.com. It's aiclub@billykeels.com. Connect. We're getting started. I'm going to be able to connect with other accredited investors, also find out about what are the different things that we're thinking about, we're talking about. Also, if there are investment opportunities, feel free to share those with you. Once again, accredited investors, anyone who has made $200,000 the previous 2 years, expected to do that in this year, or $300,000 as a family and expected to do the same thing this year, or someone who has $1 million in net worth, not including your primary residence. So if you are an accredited investor, you're interested in connecting with other people, especially those of us that have a long distance focus, this is definitely the group that you are going to want to be a part of, especially because we're just getting started. Like, that's the best time to get in. So listen, send an email to aiclub@billykeels.com and we'll look forward to connecting with you. And so as for today's conversation, like literally this guy moved from, if you're someone who you've lived in one country and you moved to another, like, or one continent to the other, and maybe you happen to work in the IT space, you work in the energy space, you feel like, hey, there's so many different things that you want to be able to do and you just didn't know where to start and you were looking for maybe that inspiration, like today's conversation is really, really one of those that you're going to want to listen to. Also, living in Southern California, he's now been able to expand network and looking across the United States and Georgia and Florida. And he talks about some of the different ways that he's actually gone about doing that, learning more about real estate, actively getting involved in real estate and being able to attract others that are in W-2s, corporate roles that also want to be able to do what they do best during the day and also make sure that they're getting more control over their financial life. So you're really going to enjoy today's conversation with Vince Rodriguez, and we're going to get to that in just a few seconds. Whether you're an active investor or a passive investor, you really like your day job and you want to continue to go into your day job every single day feeling better, knowing that you've created the right options for yourself. At the same time, you just don't have enough time to really get your head around, spend all the hours investing long distance. Well, one way or the other, over the last number of years that I have been investing long distance, I've really understood a number of the major mistakes that you should avoid if you want to get to creating the right options for yourself much faster and being able to create more income sooner. And if you want to do that, if you want to understand more about that, I've made it really, really simple. You can just go to billykeels.com/7 mistakes to avoid. You can learn all the things that The seven major mistakes that I've seen over and over again that I want you to avoid. Once again, you can go to billykeels.com/7mistakes to avoid. Now, if you've ever wanted to know how investing in multifamily real estate can really energize your life, then guess what? Today's the conversation that you're going to want to listen to until the very last word. You know why? Because today's guest not only started his professional career in the direct sales and marketing space, which is really cool and close to a lot of our hearts. He's also been a researcher focused on thermally conductive nanocomposite fibers for Lilon batteries. He's going to have to tell us about that because this sounds just super interesting. He also continues to work in the technology and development space in the energy sector, which is also something that's really close to my heart. And he is the managing partner at Envy Holdings. Gives me great pleasure to welcome to today's conversation, Vincent Rodriguez. Vincent, welcome to the show, man.
Hey, thanks for having me, Billy. Good to be here.
Hey, man, really looking forward to the conversation. I don't want to tell everybody where you live. You're gonna tell us that now, but it's always really cool. And they can, if they're watching the video version, they can actually see the sunshine shining on your face. So this is going to be awesome. Listen, as you know, want to get into a couple of things. Everybody gets five questions. You're going to get two in the beginning, three in the end. And then we're going to get to know a lot more about you and the things that you're doing in between. So first question that we want to know to get to know you a little bit more, Vincent, is help us understand, well, where exactly do you live in the United States?
So I actually live in Orange County, just south of Hollywood Town, right? South of LA. So it's a place called Costa Mesa, close to the beach by Newport Beach and stuff. That's where I live currently. But I am originally from South India, from a place called Chennai.
Oh, fantastic. Chennai, in the south of India. I told you one of the things, like I've visited 86 countries in my life and lived in a number, like less than 86, of course, but India is one of the places that I have still yet to go. So that is still on my bucket list to visit. So very cool. But now you're calling Southern California home. And with that, like, help us understand also too, what's the most positive thing that's happened to you in the last 24 hours, Vincent?
I actually talked to my immigration attorney yesterday, and I think we made some good progress in terms of acquiring my green card status pretty fast using another route.
Oh, fantastic. So right on. That's fantastic. Getting on track to get the green card. So cool. And congratulations for that. And thanks for sharing.
Thank you.
Which is fantastic. Now, listen, the Going Long family knows this already. Like, I give myself this really impossible task of trying to tell your story in like a couple seconds, which is impossible because you've done a lot of different things. And so what I'd love for you to do is share with the Going Long family, like what, tell us, I guess, more about your own backstory and tell us in your own words. And if you could also highlight some of the, like, the major decisions that you've made to get to this point in your journey. And then from there, you and I can just kind of see where the conversation goes.
Yeah, so I'm primarily a mechanical engineer. I got my undergraduates from India, and then I moved to Kansas from India, big transplant, and I did my master's there. That's when I actually, during the summers with one of my best friends, Jamike from Nigeria, we actually sold books door to door in the South in the Bible Belt. So we kind of, you know, we had a good experience with that. I came back for the second year. So, you know, I sold over $40,000 worth of Bible in two summers, just personally. And then my team sold like six figures, which is really fascinating to see that I'm able to sell a product which is free for $100,000, right? It was, we worked for Thomas Nelson Publications. So that was that. And then I finished my degree, you know, just took on a regular, engineering job, had a lot of patents. I tried my luck with, you know, intellectual property with my first company, had some shares, but you know how it is with technology. If it doesn't come to market, it's really, your shares are not worth as much. So it was bought out. So then I'm on visa. So I moved to my now company, which is Applied Medical, and I continue developing intellectual property for them. But along this process, one of my best friends, Vivek, he turned me onto the book, Rich Dad Poor Dad, obviously. And I didn't read it for like years because I was dealing with other stuff. And I finally read it in 2018, January. And then I was immediately depressed for 2 weeks straight because I was like, I wasted my whole life. This is the whole, it's everything's a scam. I'm like, I went to school for 25 years for what, you know, all that stuff. Then I started buying real estate. So I went from, it took me 2 years to buy two properties. And then during the pandemic, I went from $400,000 of asset to about $3.5 million of assets under management. It's about 30 doors. So that's my short story.
So there's a couple of things, man, and it's a short story, but packed with lots and lots of great detail and some decisions. I guess one of the things I want to kind of talk about is I know what it's like being an American who has made a decision to live in another continent. And I think one of the things that you said is you did your undergrad in India, and then you'd made a decision to head to the United States. You were there in Kansas. Before we even get into like the real estate stuff, let's just kind of pull it back, because there's a lot of people that are international or expatriated and things like that. What was your, I guess, motivation for moving from your home to a brand new continent and getting into continuing studies?
This is going to sound crazy to you guys, but when I was younger, I watched a lot of American television. And some of the shows I watched are like Seinfeld, Friends, Fresh Prince, Lost, and all those TV shows, right? And I always knew I didn't really fit in India as much because there's only so much you could do in India, and it's a lot of different things involved. There's a lot of high population. So I wanted to do things in a more grand scale. So I felt like for me, I'm not going to fit as well in India. So I made the decision to go to US when I was a young kid, and most people told me I can't do that. Like, that's not a thing, you know, but they are still back in India. So I'm here.
You know, and I only laugh because a lot of mm-hmm. times people will, if you don't put your own self-limiting beliefs, other people mm-hmm. will kind of help to put limiting beliefs on you that you can't do this or you can't do that until you start to say, well, why can't I do this? Or how do I do this? So it's really about how do you ask certain questions and then be able to push the boundaries even further. So really it had to do with just influences in your life, which were one of the things that motivated you to decide to literally move tens of thousands of kilometers away from home, or tens of thousands of miles, I guess, right?
I like that you started using kilometers like us back home in Asia.
It's been a while. I've been here for a while, man. I've been in Europe for 20 years. So at least, depending on when people are listening to this, it's at least been 20 years now. So
that's cool. That's pretty much it. It's a certain kind of lifestyle I was looking for and which was not available to me back home in India. So I was like, you know, it's even difficult to go on a date in India, right? Without like 10 aunties and my uncle's brother watching over. I'm like, I'm getting the hell out of here.
Yeah. And you know, it's interesting because everybody has different feelings and different perceptions of where they are, what they want to do, and more importantly, where they want to go in life. And so sometimes you may feel, as you mentioned before, like you felt like there was something else calling you somewhere else. And that took you to the United States. Now, I used to sell knives door to door. Like literally I would sell knives door to door. And you're talking about now selling information products door to door, like books, right? Mm-hmm. Which I know it's not easy to do that. It really is not easy to do that. And you have to learn a number of skills to be able to build rapport, build relationship, and then eventually be able to establish trust. But what was it also that took you into the door-to-door? You didn't say door-to-door, but what took you to?
It is door-to-door.
Okay, perfect. So, all right, perfect. So I made an assumption. Thank you for correcting confirming. What was it that took you to that type of a role as well?
Okay, great question, actually. So remember, I came from India. I'm an immigrant, right? I speak English because I went to a Catholic high school. My family's Catholic in India. The private schools are all Catholic and they speak the best English. So I had a good upbringing. Medium of education was English. So all those things, I had a good leg up. But when I did come here, it's a big culture shock. And I wanted to learn how different communities work. I wanted to know what the white people in Kansas are doing. I also wanted to know the black community, right? So when we went to sell books to the South, we were hitting different groups. And I was really interested in the culture. I was like, hey, what's soul food? I want to know what that is. I want to get involved with people's lives and understand how they work. So that was my first thing, to kind of get immersed in American culture and also learn how to freely talk to people, communicate without inhibitions, and then deal with rejections, right? How tough will it be if you knock on a door and they says, no, not today, and close the door on your face, and you got to deal with it every day. So it kind of like makes you into like a very different personality, because you have to do this every day for like 12 hours straight for 3 months in the summer. Most people quit. Most people did quit.
Yeah. And so this is one of the things where like a lot of people will Rather, so you were intentionally looking for something that was uncomfortable, right? Because I remember I moved to Spain in 1995 and I kind of did just the opposite. I wanted to hang out with the people that like were from the United States, and I had the best intentions to do something else. But when I got there, I realized how difficult it was. So that also, once again, and the reason I'm asking these questions is it helps to also, because there are, it helps people that are listening, part of the Going Long family today, they're thinking, wow, you know what? I feel a little bit different. It's, you know, even though everybody else is doing this thing, I feel like I want to do that thing, like the opposite thing. And it's okay. There's a lot of us out there that resonate with what you're talking about right now, Vincent. Because after I had that experience in 1995, I've kind of, my life has pivoted and I've done pretty much the opposite since then. So you were able to find that earlier. You were really looking to kind of taste and understand the different the differences in people so that you could continue to grow and move forward. So one last question, then we're really going to get into the real estate stuff, because I know a lot of people want to find out about this, but you know, this is also about mindset, right? Mm-hmm. You talked about picking up Rich Dad, Poor Dad. It took you a while. Like, I've got a confession to make here, Vincent. When I picked up Rich Dad, Poor Dad the first time, I kind of read the first part of the book. I was loving it. And then I put it down and I did not actually pick it up for a number of years, in the exact same way that you did. But once I did go through the end to end, I was like, oh my gosh, this is life altering. So what was it that made you pick the book up again when you put it down the first time?
Actually, mine is even worse than you. You at least took the chance to read it. I didn't even read it. I was just like, people are trying to kick me out of the US. So I was, you know, I was struggling with all kinds of stuff. I was changing jobs and stuff, other things. Yeah. And I was like, this has got to be some scam book. Like, I'm not doing this multi-level marketing something. But then my buddy was kept saying like, no, dude, you got to read it. And, you know, now I'm like so into this right now. You know, I like to tell people I spent the first 25 years becoming the best engineer. I'm spending the next 5 getting the hell out of it.
Yeah, well, once again, it comes down to motivation and if you're running towards something or running away from something, right? So, So I know you have a lot of what you do is in a specific area in California. That's kind of where you started. I really want to focus on like where you're going and some of the things that you're actively doing now, which gets into the whole reason of like long distance investing, which is one of the main reasons that we're here. Now, although you live in Southern California and you read Rich Dad, Poor Dad like I did, and you probably listened to a lot of podcasts and you probably watched a lot of videos on YouTube and you've probably done a lot of that stuff. And the majority of those things say, hey, listen, if you're going to be a quote unquote landlord, buy in the place that you live so that you can go to the property every day. You can check it out. You can make sure you can learn, you can do all this other kind of stuff. Everybody here listening and watching, if it's not their first time, kind of, we fundamentally don't believe that you have to do it that way. You can do it that way, but there's also another way to do it, which is long distance investing, meaning like you can be like me. I kind of take it to an extreme, living in Barcelona and investing exclusively in the United States. I know I'm kind of over the top in that way. However, I would love for you to share with the Going Long family, kind of where are some of the other investments that you're all like that you've already doing or that you're currently looking to do. I know that they happen to be long distance. And then most importantly, like it's not in your backyard. So why in the world would you ever go against popular culture and decide to invest in some place that's literally thousands of miles or hundreds of miles or thousands of miles from where you live in Southern California?
Yeah, really, really good, deep question. I think this will be a good thing for our listeners to know. So yeah, so I do also primarily believe you have to start somewhere. And if you're not going to start anywhere and you're going to just read books and be like a keyboard junkie, like we call them, then I would say start in your backyard. So for me, I live in Orange County, one of the most expensive markets in the United States, right? So I couldn't afford to buy stuff here because the yields were so low. For people who don't know what that means is when you put money down and then you buy a property, let's say with cash, well, the yield you can get it, we call it cap rate, right? It's very low. It's like less than 4, maybe 2.5, maybe 2. It's almost getting to European standards, right? So for me, I'm not in that level of investor. That's for people who are looking for wealth preservation and they can play the appreciation game. They can lose $20,000 a year in hopes to make $2 million. And they probably will if they hold it for, you know, 10, 20 years. That's not what I want to do, right? So I went started with Bakersfield, with Kern County, which is more interior. And I have about 22 units there and they bring cash flow. Now, to go back to what you're talking about is, why do we want to go long distance? I live in California, and I'm not trying to make this political, but California is a very democratic state along with New York, right? So we have laws to protect the tenants more than the guys who actually own it. So if you, for example, let's say, Billy, you own a car and then you wake up in the morning and then you go to your car and there's two guys living there. And then you say, hey, get out. And then they say, no, we have rights to live in your car for next 9 months. That's actually happening to me in California. There's a guy who's just squatting, but I can't kick him out because he has squatter rights and he's been living there for 10 months and not paying rent. So do I want to put millions of dollars of my money and my sister's money in a market where they're going to be more friendly to us tenants? So I cannot, right? I have to go to places where if somebody's burning my house, they should be able to get out. So I started looking into markets where longer markets. So my sister lives in Georgia, so I know that, understand that market very well. So I have a couple of duplexes there, one in Stone Mountain and one in Columbus, Georgia. So that's one market. And through my networking and my meetups and stuff, I've acquired some people. So I have access to deep pockets in Orange County, right? So these guys want their money to be placed in Tampa exclusively or Orlando area. So they already have 18 single families there. They have about 40 homes. So I have access to a couple million dollars in cash that wants to go to that market. So I'm actually developing a team. I actually am partnering with a GP, a general partner there, and then trying to buy. I'm trying to double my portfolio. I have about 30 units. I'm trying to double my portfolio with one deal. Yes, okay. I will get a much smaller portion of the deal, but still I could do the deal and get my name, you know, out there.
Yeah. So there's a couple of different things, right, that where you're giving us really interesting insight. Number one is that it sounds to me, and please confirm, that your focus is really primarily on increasing yields and as well as cash flow. Is that accurate?
That is accurate because, you know, how did most people lose their homes in 2008? Because they were playing the appreciation game and then they didn't make enough cash flow to just cover the debt, right? So you want to have a DSCR, at least more than one, right?
Yeah. And when you talk about DSCR, it's the debt service coverage ratio, which means the net operating income will be able to cover the debt that you have on the property. So there's just so we don't leave anybody behind. Well, when you talk about the DSCR, the debt service coverage ratio, but I guess fundamentally at the end of the day, you were clear on what it was that you wanted, like higher yields and cash flow. And so what you found is that the location where you live was not really giving you the highest probability of being able to accomplish your goal. So therefore, you went to a location where you actually knew someone, which was your sister. You talked about Georgia. You also talked about now specific locations of people that are part of the networking that you're doing that are looking at a specific location, which is the Florida area. I think you said Tampa. And with that, you are then looking for specific opportunities. So it's very much in line with the thesis that I talk about all the time, which is make sure you personally, you understand what you want to achieve. Do you look, I deal with a lot of people that are very high wage earners. They're accredited investors and they are getting crushed by taxes, right? They live in California, they live in New Jersey, they live in New York, and they're paying 50% of their, you know, of the money that they're going to work every single day, working 100% of the hours and bringing home 50% of the pay. So rather than looking for just a cash flow, they're looking for what's the best way that I can actually keep more of the money. So they're looking for tax benefits. Other people are looking for cash flow. Other people are looking for equity buildup over time and the appreciation that you talked about before. So depending on what you're looking for, then you go to the location that's going to give you the best probability of achieving that. Then you build the team. And then afterwards, you look for the opportunity. So very much in line with what I like to talk about here, what we share in the Going Long family as well. Wow, don't you just love this conversation? This is amazing. This is fantastic. And so just really quickly, I just wanted to remind you, for those of you that are looking to create more options for yourself, get there faster, and do that with long distance investing, make sure that you go to billykeels.com/7mistakes to avoid so that you can avoid all those mistakes, get to your goals faster and sooner. Once again, that's billykeels.com/7mistakes to avoid. Now back to the conversation. So one of the things that you'd mentioned is you talked about the networking. You talked about it really quickly, but what is it that you're doing? Like, what is it that, how have you found that networking is actually helping you in terms of being able to get to the goal of doubling your portfolio that you just mentioned?
Yeah, so this is actually a really nice segue to talk about. This is my favorite part. I'm passionate about real estate is one of the common beliefs that people have when you start something is you are kind of destined to know people in your circle of family and friends in your school, and you kind of are stuck there, and that is your reach of people. I am like the extreme opposite of that. I say, delete all of your garbage friends and get the hell out of there, and then make your own circle for people who believe in what you want to do. I actually now, for the last few months, refuse to hang out with my buddies in Orange County because I just don't want to do it. I will hang out with them if I want to spend so much time watching a movie or something, right? But I am not in the same mindset as them. So I started my own meetup. I run it with my buddy, Drew. We own the Envy Holdings. So he's the On and I'm the Andrew and Vince, right? So we hold a meetup. We call it RE Social. So it's like Real Asset Social. So it's at like a nice, cool location. People come hang out. And I talk very briefly about a subject, like 20 minutes, 15 minutes. And then it's just social, just mixers, just people just hang out. Through these kind of conversations, I met some of the guys who have access to a lot of capital. Now, these guys are really, really smart, right? These guys don't have to work with me, but they are older guys. They know I'm hustling. They know I don't have a lot of money. So they're willing to give me money. In fact, this guy gave me $200,000 in cash to buy the duplex in Stone Mountain, Georgia, right?
Let me just ask a question here, because this is one of the things. So that you met these people and then they're just going to give you $200,000. So a bunch of people are probably going, hang on a second. I just need to start a meetup and everybody's going to give me $200,000. That's how quickly, like, everybody is now starting their own meetup. Maybe take us through a little bit of the process when you say you started a meetup and then someone gave you $200,000. Cause I think there's probably a lot of steps in between to be able to do that. So talk to us a little bit about what you were doing to get to a point where someone entrusted you enough to provide you with $200,000 of their, you know, hard-earned capital.
Okay, so also great question. You have a lot of great questions, almost like you run your own podcast or something.
I like to actively listen every once in a while.
Yeah, that's cool. You have good active listening skills. So yeah, so what I wanted to talk about was, so I started going to, so how real estate works is, why I like this business, entrepreneurship, is you get paid for how much value you bring to the table. It's not like my day job or your day job, right? Where you can only get very linear increments, like 3%, 5%, 6%, something like that, right? But in real estate, if you bring enough value, you can make $1 million. Like that's actually true, right? So I like this aspect. So when I start going to a lot of these networking events, and I'm super nerdy. So in 2018, 19, 20, I read almost all the books available for real estate and networking, like all of it, right? And I actually find a little bit more value in podcasts than books, because the books, they kind of like, they fill up the pages, but podcast is very good for me because I can keep getting new information, like very specific, right? So what I did was I started going to these meetups, and people will ask questions and I'll have a very targeted answer to that question. For example, let's say we go to a meetup and you ask me, hey, Vince, or how many LLCs should I have to start my real estate business? And I'm going to be like, you make $10,000 at Walmart and your asset is a 1950s Honda Civic. You do not need LLCs because you have nothing for me to take from you. This is not the right questions for you. Your right question is, how do I meet the guy, bring value, get into the first deal, right? So those kind of things. So people start seeing me for what this is. So I start creating my own meetup and I talk about like different topic. Actually, I just wrote last night a blog. It's on my website. It's why is cash trash? So it's like, you know, because cash, they keep printing more, you know, value goes down and stuff, assets.
Oh, yeah. They're printing trillions of it every, I think it's a couple billion every month they're printing. So, or at least in terms of creating new reserves, I don't know if they're actually printing, but they're creating new reserves, billions of them every single month, at least in the Fed, European Central Bank's doing the same and all this other kind of stuff. So, so that's interesting. So it's really about as you have your meetup, not only are you creating a social environment, but you're also sharing what your opinion is with others and entering in conversations and helping other people grow, taking new perspectives. And I guess one of the byproducts of doing that over time and doing it consistently could be building a trustful relationship where someone will, based on the things that you've talked about, and I'm sure all of the legal documentation that they go through, they feel compelled to invest their time, energy, and capital with you on specific projects. Would that be accurate?
Yeah. So it's pretty much just trying to develop a trust relationship. Like for my sister, I don't have to develop a trust relationship. I literally called her. Yes. She called me yesterday and she said, why did I wire money to pay this guy's car off? I don't even know who this guy is. So I'm closing another part, like a deal with my buddy, but he has this Tesla loan and, you know, the DTI gets hit. So I need to pay off his car to get the loan for him. Right. But these kind of things I could just do, but without me, the deal can't happen because I have access to these people who will give me money to close deals and I'll pay them back after the deal closed or give them equity, stuff like that. So those kind of things you can only develop if people constantly come to your meetups, they see you on social media and they know what they're talking about. And really, I don't really ask for their money. That's the whole concept. Like just come to my meetup, hang out. You will know. It is better for you to give me money or a Billy money because we know more than you at this point. But I always tell them you should do, as long as you're willing to lose the first deal and lose some money, long-term you will be better off. But if you're a working professional, you're making 200 grand, it's not a good use of your time to try to figure out how to get a deal in Tampa. You're going to waste 3 months. You could have made a lot of money.
Yeah, yeah. And this is part of the process, right? When, as you're helping to educate or show people, provide an opportunity, like what does that look like, especially for working professionals? You know, where do you get the best return of your time? So speaking of that, like, because you are also in the IT sector or the technology development sector we talked about before, specifically different industries, right? But I'm curious as to what are some of the things before we get into the going long final three that you actually see from a lot of corporate professionals where they're interested in real estate, but they don't really know how to get started. They don't really understand, like, should I be doing this actively? Should I be doing this passively? Maybe talk to us about what you see from other corporate professionals that are in this head. They're in this headspace that they don't know whether or not they want to move forward. And maybe what are some of the different reasons that you find that they don't move forward or that they do move forward with real estate?
Yeah, good question. So for most corporate professionals, including me, at some point, most of us think that for one, it's some kind of a scam. I'm trying to take their money, right? And they have a fear of the unknown. They don't quite understand how it works. So they're like, why would I give you money? I'm like, you are not really giving me money. You're going to give money to an escrow account. Then we buy a property in both our names. There's no transaction between you and me. There's documents in place. I have a JV agreement written by my lawyer. We have tenants in common. We hold title like that. But once they start coming to these meetups, I educate them. Then they start getting the understanding of what it works. And a lot of people also think, because I'm like, oh, I'm a smart engineer. I have 10 patents on things, so I could also do real estate. Yeah, you could, but you never will because you're going to always read a book and just be holding on to things and you will never go to the next stage because you're scared.
Yeah. And so this is one of the things that can happen quite frequently is when you're in a corporate role, a lot of times the roles are defined, the outcomes are really defined through specific either MBOs, management by objectives, or specific KPIs, which are the key performance indicators like that you're driving towards that. So everything's pretty much defined. The larger the organization, the more defined it is. And then when you move into an entrepreneurial world, it's kind of like an open highway and things aren't really as defined. And sometimes that can generate some fear. Sometimes that can generate, for some of us, it generates massive opportunity. So when you're having those types of conversations, it's, these are exactly the types of things that we typically are going to hear. But so listen, man, it's time for us to get to the going long final three. But the thing is, I never ask anybody the going long final three unless they tell me you're ready. So you know what, Vince, are you ready?
Let's go, brother.
All right, here we go. Listen, the first, the going long final three, we started with you over in Southern California. And I'd like to bring it back here to me and everybody that's here in Europe. So help us understand, what is your favorite European city that you've either visited or is still on your bucket list to visit?
So I have been to England, like about a decade ago. I have family there, Leicester, which is the north of London. So that was a nice little small town, but I really like London, walking around, going to the, where all the kings and queens hang out, So that was kind of cool. I really like the tube, we took the tube, so that was kind of fun. So I enjoyed that.
All right, fantastic. And mind the gap, of course. So we'll go ahead and give that vote to London. Another vote for London. So fantastic city, by the way. Love it as well. So listen, here's question number two of the Going Long Final Three really has to do with successful people. And I've seen so many, I've been very, very fortunate. I've seen lots of successful people. I've interviewed lots of successful people on this podcast. You're a successful person. You talked to us about a number of the things that you've done already. And I guess one of the things, Vince, that I see with a lot of successful people is that one of the main reasons that they're very successful is because very successful people like you, like typically don't make any mistakes. And that's why you're so much further by design. It was by design, by the way. So no, it is kind of a joke. It's a joke with the entire Going Long family. But here's the thing. The reality is successful people, not only do they make mistakes, you know, Vince, they make a lot more mistakes than most people, a whole lot more. But the reality is those people that are successful, they do one thing very, very differently. And I'm sure that you will agree here. And so with every single mistake, those successful people really stop. They learn from the mistake, and then they put different steps in place to try to not make the exact same mistake twice, right? And so I would love for you to think about not really the mistakes or the learning opportunities or however you want to call it, Vince, but really what was the one lesson that you know that the Going Long family could really, really use today? So what is that one lesson that you would share with the entire Going Long family today?
Yeah, the biggest thing was my limiting belief of believing that I could only do engineering work my entire life and doing those kind of stuff, right? My limiting belief stopped me from buying assets and stuff. So I went beyond that. And then I started, you know, the networking stuff we talked about, meeting people. So that's also was my limiting belief. I can only talk to the person I already know. I can only talk to the girl I already know, right? Now I could just walk to anyone and talk to them. That was my big,
fantastic. Love that. So really focus on not letting those limiting beliefs hold you back, really continue to move forward. And, you know, there's, what do they say? Like your growth happens outside of your comfort zone. So, that's fantastic. Appreciate you sharing that with us as well. And then Vince, the final of the Going Long Final Three really has to do with helping to feed our minds. And so I would love for you to share with me and the entire Going Long family, what is one book that you would recommend to the Going Long family today?
It's got to be other than Rich Dad Poor Dad.
It can be whatever you want, man.
Okay, well, if you're not in the game, that's the book you have to read it. And then I would also recommend, highly recommend the follow-up book he did, Robert Kiyosaki's book, A Cash Flow Quadrant. Actually, it tells you which side of the quadrant you have to be. You don't want to be an employee. You know, you want to be an investor. So that's something I recommend.
Fantastic. So the cash flow quadrant is one that we're going to add to your book recommendation. So we'll take that one if that's okay with you. And wow, man, I just, you know what, the conversation goes by super fast. Like from the very beginning, we're talking about you leaving India, moving to Kansas, you're selling books door to door. Not only are you selling, you then get a team that is selling six figures of worth of sales. And then from there, you end up going to California, Southern California, sunny Southern California, which is an absolutely fantastic place. You get into recognizing that you want to have more control over your life. You picked up Rich Dad Poor Dad, you put it down a couple years later, you then pick it up again, you read it, and then you go, oh, wow, what have I done with the last 25 years of my life? Because it's that impactful. And since then, you've continued to take action. You are now on a path to double your portfolio. You're doing that through networking with other people. You're looking not only to invest close to where you live, but also even looking to invest across the country in states like Georgia and states like Florida, which is fantastic. You're building networks and you're also helping impact other people's lives positively. And so Vince, I know that, you know, it's really cool being able to talk to you and being able to reach out to you. You know, I can do that, but I'd love for you to share with the Going Long family, those people that want to reach out to you, like what is the best way for the Going Long family to reach out to you and get to know more about you and what you're doing at Ovni Holdings?
Yeah, man. So all my tags are the same. It's on V Invest. So it's A-N as in Andrew, right? And then V-I as in Vince, and then Invest, one word. So that's my Instagram handle. That's the website. You can, you know, go to onvinvest.com/blog. We write blogs, a lot of good value. But you can also email me at Vince@onvinvestments.com.
Fantastic. Vince at OnVInvestments. Vincentrodriguez.com on the invest to where you can find you on the different websites and different handles. We're also going to include those in the show notes. So listen, Vince, I really appreciate you investing your time with me and the entire Going Long family, man. And I appreciate it. And I really, really want to thank you for investing your time with us. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Billy. Thanks for having me.
It's my pleasure. And just a quick couple seconds for the Going Long family. Listen, thanks once again for investing your time with Vince and I today. I hope you've enjoyed this while you're either running or walking or on your treadmill or doing whatever it is that you do. And so, you know, I'm looking forward to welcoming you back on the very next conversation. So until then, go out and make it a great day. And thank you very much. Freedom. Wow. Don't you love hearing from top-notch experts in the field? You know, when I was getting started, I really wish that I would have had access to such experts. And even more, I wish they would have given me like a really simple list of things to follow so that I could have gotten to my goals much faster and been much happier even sooner. So that's why I've created for you the 7 things that you should avoid in order to be successful in long distance investing. And you can pick that up really easily by going to billykeels.com/7things to avoid. And also, if you liked today's episode, don't forget to leave a 5-star review. I'm looking forward to seeing you on our very next episode, so go out and make it a great day.